for matching. Well, good morning, Calvary Chapel. Y'all look ready to worship. I love it. Let's go ahead and stand. We want to welcome those who are tuning in online. So great to have you guys joining in and tuning in. God is good, guys. Even when we have a rough week or sometimes things don't go our way, we need to know that God is still in control. And he loves us very much. So no matter what we're going through, he will be by our side and he will never let us go. So more importantly, as we are here together as a congregation, so important to just come before the Lord and have his Holy Spirit come and rest in this place. So let's go ahead and give this time into the Lord's hands. Dear Heavenly Father God, we just want to thank you. We want to praise you. This morning, Father God, Lord, we want to give you all control of everything that is going on, Lord. Even with all the chaos that is happening in this world, you are still in control and you are seated high on the throne. So, Father, I pray that we can just lay any heavy burden, anxiety, or stress into your hands, Lord, and we can just allow you and your Holy Spirit to do the work that needs to be done. We want to give you glory and praise. So, Father, I pray as we come together as a congregation that we can give you our hearts, Lord, and sing our praises as a joyful noise. May it be a sweet sound to your ear, Father God, as your people come and sing to you, Lord, for everything you have done. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We love you in your precious and holy name. Amen. Open the eyes of the blind, no one like you. Amen, amen. He is worthy to be praised. You may be seated as we continue to worship. Jesus, we sing of how great you are. And Father, you are. You are so great. And you are so loving and you are so gracious to your people, Lord. Even when we're stubborn. How your love has just shown so much through our lives, Father. And as we are here before your presence, Father, singing your praises, Lord, we just want to thank you for everything that you have done, for everything that you have provided for your children, Lord. We have never been without one. You have been such a good, good Father, Lord, and we praise and lift your name for being so loving and constant and never failing us. And Lord Jesus, with the things that are happening in this world, Father, we see a lot of chaos. We see a lot of things on the news that just breaks our hearts. But Father, we know that you're coming soon. We know that you're coming soon. But in the meantime, Lord, you have brought us here for such a time as this, Lord, to represent your name, Father. We have been given such a wonderful privilege to be able to be here in a country where we have the freedom to worship you and freedom to proclaim your name, Father, a freedom given by you. And Lord, I just pray that, Lord, we don't take that for granted, that we can come boldly and we can finish the race strong until you come and take your church home. Give us the boldness. Let your spirit speak so loudly, Lord, that people cannot deny who you are. Let us reflect you, Father. And as we come into this time of offering, I pray, Lord, that it may be given to you in a spirit of worship. Thank you, Father, for always providing for us, Lord. Even when doubt may come our way or, Lord, we worry or anxious, you have always fulfilled your promises, Lord, and you will continue to do so. So, Lord, I just also want to lift up the people who are suffering with illnesses, Lord. I pray, Father, your healing hand on their bodies. We believe in the God who performed miracles in the Bible. That is the same God that we serve today. We believe fully and truly that you have that power to heal. So let us lay it all before your feet, Father. Let us continue to abide and worship in you in spirit and in truth. We love you, Father, in your precious and holy name. Amen.
is our God.
Say amen. Your name lifted high, amen.
Thank you.
Father God, you overcame. Oh, Father, how much we needed to hear those words. Lord, that you are will and will always be by our sides, Father. That you have already come into this world, you have overcome, and now you are with us, Lord Jesus. What an amazing privilege it is, Father God, to be here in your presence, Lord, to witness just your church singing your praises unto your name, because you deserve all glory and honor and praise, Father, for everything you have done for us, for everything that you continue to do in our lives, Lord. Let us wake up, Father. Let us wake up and stand firm in our faith. Let us be steadfast, Father. We want to finish the race strong. So, Lord, I pray for your Holy Spirit to ignite that fire in our souls, in our hearts, Lord, to have a passion for your name and a passion for your word, Lord Jesus. And as we do open up your word this morning, Father, I pray that your spirit does speak through Pastor Rob, Lord. We are here to listen to you, Father. Abba in heaven, we want to hear from you. So stir in our hearts now. I pray we put all distractions aside, Lord, that will keep us, Lord, from drawing near to you. This time is in your hands, Lord. We give it to you, Father. May this be a sweet sound to your ears. We love you, and all of God's children say together now. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. Good morning, church family. Thank you, worship team, as always. I am blessed to be able to share announcements with you this morning. So if you can grab your bulletin, we'll go over what we have in store. The insert, a couple of things in the month of May, right around the corner. May already, if you can believe that. May 11th is the swap meet. So if you're interested in our spring version of our swap meet, If you haven't been aware, the youth sell parking lot spaces to have a swap meet here to get rid of your old stuff. And if you're interested, your old stuff is always someone else's new stuff. So feel free to stop by in the foyer after service and inquire about how many spaces are left and how you can support the youth. That's May 11th from 7 a.m. to noon. Just below that, ladies, your day, your royal tea party, honoring daughters of the Most High King is coming up May 18th, 1:30 here in the sanctuary. So that's Saturday, May 18th. So if you're interested in going, there's a sign up in the back, or if you need to have more details or ask questions, I'm sure somebody will be there to answer all the questions. I don't have many answers for you, but I'm sure one of our lovely ladies will. Inside the bulletin, full of things like literally right around the corner, some like today. So there's a common theme I was looking at it this morning, and the 21st just keeps popping up all over the page. So upper left corner, guitar workshop with our own Jeff Cadell. Lead guitarist that is back to my far right here during worship. He'll be doing a guitar workshop over in the fellowship hall, high school room at 2:30 this afternoon. Oh, he's now made it down into the sanctuary. So thanks, Jeff, for that beautiful ministry. If you've never gone, if you're afraid to play a guitar, it's a good place to go to start. They will walk you through. If you're seasoned, don't hesitate to go and join them as well. They're looking for all various skill levels. So join them. It's a great ministry that Jeff has going. Just below that, the Women's Bible Study this coming Monday, April 22nd at 7 p.m. And then again Wednesday, April 24th in Galatians Lesson 4. So ladies, come and join in some time and fellowship and in the world and in the Word. God, Girls, and Guns, just below that. So it is right around the corner next Saturday, ladies, the 27th. Final deadline to sign up will be the 23rd, so we're extending a couple days into the week. So if you have an interest in going, contact the office, and we'll get you on the list up until the 23rd. I encourage you to sign up today, because I'm the one that has to shuffle all the names around for the list, so the sooner I get it, the better. But nonetheless, we'll definitely take you up until Tuesday the 23rd. After that, it gets a little sticky. And then we're watching the weather, so we're keeping a watchful eye on the weather. So keep in your prayers this week. I know we've had rain, and we always need rain, but maybe we could put rain off another week so we can get next Saturday, the 27th, in. So just pray for the event. I know the ladies love it, and for us to have to come Thursday or Friday, put the word out that we have to postpone it wouldn't be fun for us. So we encourage those that are interested, please come out, join a great day of fellowship with the ladies. Upper right corner, Constitution class. Another class starting May 1st with David and Deborah Fluke. Deborah came by this morning and shared that for those of you that might be on the list for pre-ordered books, they are in, and she has them in the foyer for you. So feel free to stop on by after service and grab your book. She does have extras as well. So if you've been on the fence about signing up for the class, it sounds like there's space available. She's nodding her head, and maybe that extra book will just convince you that it's there for you for the taking. So enjoy the class. We've heard wonderful things about it. Just below that, coming up on the deadline, again, the 21st, right? So that is today, if you haven't looked at your calendar yet. So for those of you that are on the list and have committed to the trip in August, the Journey to the Ark and Creation Museum, your deposits must be in by today. So please make sure you see someone in the back. I'm sure they're there to be able to take your deposits. If you have any questions, feel free to stop by and see me in between services. I'll be kind of in the foyer as well, or you can speak to Pastor Rob. Just below that, mark your calendars if all that I just shared wasn't enough. There's plenty of other things there to mark down and get on the calendar well into June and July, as you can see. So with that, we'd like to welcome anybody that might be here new or visiting. If you're bold enough to raise your hand, we'd love to say good morning and hello. There you go, one guy at the ranch. I always love to give a shout out to the guys. They're here two rows deep today, so God bless. It's awesome to have you guys here. And so for everybody else, feel free to stand up, give each other a big Calvary Chapel hug. God bless.
Well, good morning to all of you. Good morning. Don't think that just because you like squat down that I didn't see you come in, okay? good to see everyone here this morning. We finally got some sunshine, huh? Man, you know, we were talking that we hopped on the motorcycle and went up to Julian, and then, what? Which one? No, we won't show it. We hopped on the motorcycle, went up to Julian and Mount Laguna, and you would not believe how many people were out yesterday. Hikers, all the hiking locations were packed. More motorcycles out there than I've seen in a long time. So we kind of laugh because it's like the sun came out and so did the rest of the world, you know what I mean? But we were laughing because in Germany, when we've been to Germany, the sun will come out and they will, all the ice cream shops open, and all the chairs and tables go outside, and people sit outside and eat ice cream. And so that's what I'm intending on doing today. And so, anyway, gang, just to let you know, our ministry that we provide food for our community through a ministry that we have here, Sowed, and they have leftover pineapples and white onions. And so, in fact, we served 583 people yesterday. Good job, man. You guys must have been busy, huh, Steve? Awesome. That is awesome. So also, gang, for our trip to the Ark, if you want to go, we're going to have it. Today's the cutoff because the airlines are saying, hey, we need our deposit. If we don't have it, then we have to give the airline their seats back. So if you are on or desiring to go, today's the day you got to get that deposit in, or else you will lose your spot, okay? So just kind of giving you that FYI for those of you that are desiring to go. So so last week, I had mentioned to you that, and it kind of came in the midst of our conversation, of what transpired on October 7th over in Israel, where those of the Hamas came across the border, and it was wild because they knew exactly where to go in the various kibbutzes. Remember, do you guys remember me sharing that with you? It was a week ago, so I know that's a long time, right? So people were saying, Rob, you know, how do you know that's true? Okay, so you remember Ken that was here, our guest speaker for our men's retreat. So they had a trip to Israel. So it's in the Calvary magazine. So we have several of them on the round table back there. And so Ken was one of the group that got to go to Israel. If I'd have known, man, I would have went with them. And so they met with the kibbutz leaders, some of the various kibbutz people that were living in some of those kibbutzes. And the whole story is right in here in the Calvary magazine, where they were inviting these Palestinians into their kibbutz as friends and guests. And they had them come in, and they were feeding them. They were going into Gaza, helping them with various tasks. They were letting some of these from Gaza help them with their tasks. But all the while, these guests were drawing maps, and they were plotting, and they gave that information back to Hamas. So some people say, well, you know, the Palestinian people aren't a part of that. Yeah, well, many of them were. And so the whole story is right here. They talked to various people, eyewitnesses that were there. And so they knew, you know, because each kibbutz, they have, a place where they lock up some of their arms to protect themselves. Well, Hamas knew exactly where those were, where the people slept, what time they ate, who was there on Saturday, everything, all the details, all in this magazine. So if you were curious about that, grab the magazine and you can read all about it right there, okay? And Ken was one of the ones that was there. So I just wanted you to know that I didn't just pull that out of thin air or something like that. It's based upon fact, okay? So with that said, why don't you open up your Bibles to the book of Acts chapter 24. We made it part of the way through last week. And so we learned so far that Paul has been being held at the governor's, basically his mansion, his palace at the Mediterranean at Caesarea, which actually is, if you ever get to go to Israel with us, Caesarea is absolutely drop-dead gorgeous. I mean, it is one of my favorite places to go to. And right on the Mediterranean, beautiful. And so he was taken there because he went to Jerusalem. And so I'm going to share something with you guys today that I believe is a piece of the puzzle that we have. But here he is, too hot to handle in Jerusalem. He goes to Jerusalem, his heart's desire, I want to speak to the Jewish people. I'm a Jew. I love my Jewish people. I was born, I was raised as a Jew. I was, you know, trained by Gamaliel. I mean, Paul would have been the perfect guy to convince the Jews that Jesus is the Messiah. He gets to Jerusalem and it blows up. He's too hot to handle. There's a group of Jews that want him dead. They do not have a good reason. Paul literally escapes with a mini army, and they take him by Roman, you know, escort all the way into Caesarea. So Felix, the governor that we talked about, he allows Paul some freedom, and he's not allowed to leave the palace, but he's allowed to have guests and visitors come in. So it's not like, you know, super max prison or anything like that. It's more club fed, or club med, really, for Paul, right? And so God has given him some rest and relaxation. What Paul does with that, I'll give you an idea. So he's holding him there till his accusers arrive. And so the Sanhedrin finally gets there. They have a hired lawyer named Tertullus. You remember, we talked about him last week. Full of lies and deceit, as most lawyers are. Or politicians either, you know, but we won't go there. So anyway, he lays out some attack on Paul. And I'm sorry if you're an attorney here or watching. Please, I apologize. Okay. Because maybe you're a good one. And maybe there is one out there that is not like that. Okay. So just to make sure that I don't get too much hate mail. So as he shares with these guys, it's kind of wild because he gets another opportunity to talk to the Sanhedrin. 70 of the most powerful Jews in all of Jerusalem and the high priest. So 71 of them would be there. And Paul gets a second opportunity. I mean, talk about, does God love these guys or what? That he gives them another chance, a private audience with the Apostle Paul. And Paul, probably one of the greatest defenders of the faith, understood grace like no one else ever understood it. And he shares with these guys and it blows up again, right? And so they're accusing him of all different kinds of things. But Paul admitted to three things: that he was a follower of the way, he was a believer in the scriptures, and he believed that there's life after death. And I think those are three things that we should hang on to as believers. And man, hopefully that if you ever got arrested, they would have enough evidence to prove that of you, as they did with Paul. So we left him, you know, Paul, waiting for Felix to give an answer. And so that's kind of where we picked this back up today. You know, he had watched Paul. He had listened to Paul. He has a letter, remember, from Claudius. Lysias, the general in Jerusalem at the fortress in Jerusalem, he's got a letter. He knows exactly what's happened. So he knows the Jews are lying. And yet, what will he do with this? You know, what is with this guy Felix? What is in his bag of tricks? We want to find out, right? So how many of you went and looked up Felix the cat last week? I'm just kidding. Okay, good. Very good. All right. So someone sent me the whole song, because I couldn't remember some of the words to it. But, you know, I don't want that to be in your head for the rest of the service today, right? So pray with me, would you? Lord, we do want to say thank you for your word. Thank you for your truth. Thank you for this story, Lord, that on some occasions it might be worthy of just kind of blowing through it. But I think, Lord, that everything means something in your word. And today we want to find out what that is. And in order for us to do that, we need you to be the one to speak to our hearts. So Lord, we ask that of you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, you guys. So chapter 24, we pick it up verse 22. And so look what it says. So when Felix heard these things, you can circle that word heard these things, having a more accurate knowledge of the way. Remember, that is something that the Jews were accusing him of. He's a follower of the way, and Paul admitted that he was. He adjourned the proceedings, and then he said, when Lysias, the commander, comes, when he comes down, so remember, he's the general that is at the fortress, I will make a decision on your case. So he commanded the centurion to keep Paul and to let him have liberty. And he told him not to forbid any of his friends to provide for him or visit him. And after some days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him. There it is again. You can circle that one again. concerning the faith in Christ. Now, as he reasoned, meaning Paul, reasoned about, look at the three things that he does: righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come. Felix was afraid, and he answered, "Go away for now, and when I have a convenient time, I will call for you." Meanwhile, he also hoped that money would be given to him by Paul that he might release him. Do you guys know what that's called? Bribery. Very good. Okay. Therefore, he sent for him more often and conversed with him. Verse 27, but after 2 years, Porcius Festus succeeded Felix, and Felix, wanting to do the Jews a favor, left Paul bound. So we wrap up that chapter in an interesting way. So Felix, this crazy cat that we meet right here, interesting guy. What is fascinating is what we learn about Felix and how do we apply some of this stuff into our own life. Well, it's interesting. Felix has seen things. He has seen it because we see that he has a more accurate knowledge of the way. So the way, remember we talked about that, is what Jesus is, the way, the truth, and the life. And so people that in that early days, the early Christians, were called followers of the way because they followed the way Jesus lived. They wanted to behave the way that Jesus behaved. They wanted to handle adversity the way Jesus did. So the way became, if you will, an acknowledgement of the early Christians. But many of the Jews wouldn't use the word Christian because they would say Christ, which means the anointed one, and they're not going to admit that Jesus was the anointed one. So they're not going to use that word. And so they're not going to use words that would identify Jesus as the Messiah. So it's just the way. They were the followers of the way. And so the church embraced it. It was okay, right? And so he knows about Jesus. He knows about the Christian movement. Felix is aware of it even before Paul got to him. So he was probably anxious to find out from Paul, knowing this guy's one of those leaders in that movement called the Way. So he was probably anxious to talk to him. But isn't it interesting that even with all the knowledge that Felix has, in and of itself will not save a person? Just because you have knowledge about something doesn't mean then that that is knowledge that has changed you or that you've embraced it. So even though Felix might know about Jesus, he might know about this Christian movement, knowing about it has done him absolutely no good. Because in order, the only way that it's going to do you any good is when you surrender to that knowledge and appropriate that knowledge to yourself and say, that's what I now believe. But he's not doing that yet. So I think it's fascinating because we live in a world right now where many people know about Jesus. They know the historical figure. They know that Jesus existed. Many will call him, well, he was a great teacher. He was a great rabbi. So, you know, many Jews will acknowledge that, yeah, he was a rabbi. He was a good teacher. But if you really think about what they're saying, because if Jesus really was a good rabbi, well, then he was absolutely a nutcase because he claimed to be the Son of God. And so then, he's, you know, as we've read in other books before, he was either a liar or a lunatic. But you can't have him as a great teacher without embracing who he was. So it's interesting that people will dance around that. So does it mean that people that know about Jesus, does that then mean that they are saved? The answer is no. In fact, if you want to write this down next to, say, verse 22 there where we began, write down James chapter 2, verse 19, which is interesting because this is the James that isn't showing up to help Paul out. But James, I think something happens to him later. So James says, you believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe that and they tremble. Isn't it interesting that Felix trembles also with the knowledge of something, but he's unwilling to surrender to that. So Satan knows about Jesus, but is Satan, we would say that Satan even acknowledges that Jesus is the Savior, but has Satan surrendered to Jesus? No. So then Satan, we're not going to see Satan when we get to heaven. We're not going to say, dude, you finally got saved. That's amazing, right? That's not going to happen. So Felix, like so many others, has seen the reality of Jesus. He has acknowledged who Jesus is. He has acknowledged that this movement called the Christian movement, he has seen that light, and yet he chooses to walk away and to walk in darkness. Kind of sad, really, when we look at Felix. So more on that in just a second. But the question that we kind of want to ask ourselves is, okay, well, wait a minute. How does Felix know about Jesus? How did he gain this knowledge? Well, we are given a little bit of information. He had a wife named Drusilla. Now, Drusilla's an interesting lady. You might even say maybe her nickname is Godzilla. I don't know. But she's an interesting lady, right? Because she is a Jew. Josephus, the Jewish historian, tells us a little bit about her. Tacitus also tells a little. You kind of got to go outside to find out some of this information. So she was the wife of Felix, the Roman governor, who heard Paul's case. Okay, there's where we get the main piece of our puzzle, right? So she was the youngest daughter of Herod Agrippa the First. So is this starting to come together, right? Okay. So she was engaged to a guy named Epiphanes. In order for him to marry her, the requirement was you need to become a Jew and be circumcised. He said, I ain't doing it. So he called off the wedding. And so then she got married to a guy named King Aziz. And he did agree to be circumcised. So this guy, they get married. And then Adamas, a magician from Cyprus. So here we see Felix hires this magician because he sees how beautiful Drusilla is. And he goes, I want that girl. Well, she's married to Aziz. So he hires a magician to go and speak in front of Aziz and Drusilla and to say, you're not supposed to be with this man. I am receiving from the realm of the spirit. You're supposed to be married to Felix. She buys into it. So she leaves Aziz and marries Felix, but never gets divorced from Aziz. So she is living in open adultery, open to all to see that. Isn't that crazy? So, I mean, you thought the politicians of our current culture were crooked and demonic. Well, they've been that way forever, okay? That's the way it is, right? Sounds like Washington, D.C. right here. So she marries Felix, but she's still married to Aziz. So do you remember Herod Agrippa? He was the guy that killed John back in Acts chapter 12. After that incident, the Herods loved going up to Caesarea. So you may remember what happened to him. He gets all proud. He gets all puffed up. He takes the glory. I am the great Herod. And he falls down ill. And as he's laying there, his stomach opens up and worms come out of his gut. So he had a bad case of worms that was very obvious to everybody that was there, right? So the worms eat him up. So it's possible, highly possible, that her father and grandfather told her about this Messiah that could be coming, and that maybe she was watching and monitoring this whole thing, this whole Jesus movement, and then she maybe, shared that with Felix, who was kind of technically her third husband. And by the way, she did all this by the time she was 19 years old. So at 16, the girl's already married, right? I mean, she's gotten into a lot of trouble. I got in a lot of trouble by the time I was 19, but not that much, okay, right? So, and maybe as governor, I mean, when you're a governor, and by the way, Felix was born as a slave, and his brother became good friends with Claudius. Claudius really, liked Felix's brother, and so he gets him out, and they call him freedmen. So he was the one and only really a freedman, a former slave that became a governor, but they tell us that he ruled, even though as a now free man, he ruled them as a slave. So he was very harsh, very like a dictator. So he probably from Drusilla, or maybe because he's a governor, needs to be aware of these things, he finds this out. And so Paul gets this chance to speak and to preach to Felix and to Drusilla in person. I mean, can you imagine this? And what I love about Paul is he doesn't soften. He doesn't go politically correct on them. He doesn't back off. He speaks the truth in love, which is something that he will tell the Ephesians to do in Ephesians chapter 4. And when you get to verse 15, speak the truth in love. And he does that. And so, as we've done with some of Paul's other messages, let's take a look, because I had you kind of, I emphasized a few things as we went through it, because I think that if we can learn from it, I think that would help us to be able to share our faith with people. And one of the things that I want you to remember is don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, you be bold. And I think that is something that we need to be praying for living in these last days. And so, first thing that he does is he reasoned to them about righteousness. Did you catch that? About righteousness. Righteousness, what it means is that I now have a right standing with God. So how is that obtained? It's not obtained through the system of Judaism. You can't earn it. You can't earn by being a good person. You know, we can't say, well, you know, I'm a good person. And so the next time somebody tries that one on you, and that, you know, you say, well, I'm a Christian. Well, I'm a good person. Ask them a simple, quick question. Compared to who? Because if you want to use this, I'm a good person compared to, so for instance, you could say, well, Rob, I'm a good person compared to you. I mean, if I'm going to use you as my standard, that's a pretty low standard of good, okay? But at least I know that I'm better than you, Rob, okay? Well, then I could look at somebody around me in my circle of friends and find somebody who's below me. And so the standard of good is really kind of a weak standard, because just ask them, good compared to who? And then that will open the door. Well, you know, I'm good based upon my morals and values. Okay, well, what morals and values do you have? Guys, just ask questions. You'll watch people squirm. That's when it gets fun, okay? So then you can say, okay, well, according to the Bible, let me tell you what the standard of good is. And you take them to the Romans road. So Romans chapter 3, verse 10, that it says, this is written, as it is written, there is none good, no, not one. When we compare ourselves to Jesus Christ, now you have the standard of good by which we must compare ourselves with. He never made a mistake. He never erred. He never lost his temper. He never lusted. I mean, amazing, right? So when we think of good, it means perfect, without a flaw. Now, if they then say, yeah, that's me. No, you just blew it because you just told a lie. Okay, so your standard just dropped, right? So there is none good. All have turned aside. All have become unprofitable. So good is never good enough when you compare it to perfection, which is Jesus himself. So there is the standard. So the crazy thing is that, you know, many people want to blame the reason why they're not perfect. Well, Rob, you don't understand the home that I was raised in. You don't understand my past. You don't know my parents. You don't know the neighborhood that I was raised in. Okay, all of that may be valid reasons why you can call yourself a victim, but it doesn't change the reality that good is still the standard of perfection. And so, how do we measure up to that righteousness that God demands? How do we get that? How do we obtain that kind of perfection? Well, in and of yourself, you're going to never get that. But see, isn't that interesting that many religious systems, that's how they base it upon. You got to try harder. You got to do more. You got to go knock on doors. You got to wear a little black tie with a little badge that says elder such and such. You got to do things. But in a relationship with Jesus, that's not how it happens. You surrender to him. You embrace him. He is perfection. Do you see? It's not based upon us doing anything other than saying, I surrender. Jesus, I want you to be my Savior. The moment that that happens, he takes his perfection and puts it into your account. In other words, something amazing happens. Not only does Jesus move into you, which is amazing. You know, I was trying to explain that to my 5-year-old granddaughter just last night. And, well, Jesus doesn't go into my heart. And try to explain that to a 5-year-old, right? I'm saying, well, no, but you know, when you're not with grandpa and grandpa's not with you, but yet you still know that I love you and you still, I mean, it was a fun conversation. And from a guy from Hoover, I mean, that's at my level, 5 years old, right? So amazing when you think about it. We receive this perfection from Jesus. So again, in Romans chapter 3, verse 21, write this down. But now, God has shown us a different way of being right in His sight. Not by obeying the law, in other words, not by doing anything, but by the way promised in the Scriptures long ago. We are made right in God's sight when we trust in Jesus Christ to take away our sins, and we all can be saved in the same way, no matter who or what we have done. So in other words, when we put our faith in Jesus, Jesus moves into you. But then something else happens in the realm of the Spirit that a lot of people don't talk about. You read about that in Romans chapter 6. God, not only did He move in to you by His Spirit, His presence moves in. When He moves in, gang, you're different. You will never be the same from that day forward. But then God does something crazy in the realm of the Spirit. He takes you and He puts you in Christ. So now, the cool thing is, when God looks at you and He looks at me, He sees us through the filter of perfection. He sees us through Jesus Himself. Aren't you glad of that? Now, you see me here. You see the imperfect Rob, right? But God says, well, I see him perfect. I see him through the filter of Jesus. So now you have a righteous standing that gains you access into the kingdom of heaven. What did you do to deserve that? Nothing. You put your faith in Jesus, who did it all for you. All He asks you to do is believe, to surrender to that. And His righteousness becomes yours. Not by any work that you did. You didn't do anything to deserve it. Well, you know, God needed me. I'm kind of a trophy. No, I don't know if you fully surrendered yet then, okay? You know, no, He gives it because of His goodness, not because of yours. Because of your willingness to say, I surrender, I'm done. I'm tired of being empty. I'm tired of being lonely. I'm tired of carrying this weight around on my shoulders. I surrender. So the righteousness then is technically not yours. It's His, but He gives it to you on His behalf. And how much did it cost you? It's a free gift. But it cost Him everything. So hold it carefully, please. Recognize the precious gift that it is, and you hold on to that very graciously. So those people that think just being a good person is good enough, they're in for a rude awakening. That's why it's good for you to remind them. Tell me what your standard of good is. Get them to tell you that. And then tell them what the standard is, perfection. And then you can show them that Jesus is that. Well, then the second thing, so isn't this interesting? Who's He telling this to? Drusilla and Felix, who are living in open adultery in front of the whole world. Even the Romans look at Felix and they don't like him. Isn't that interesting? And so, does Paul back up? But I want you to notice he doesn't say, like you. John the Baptist did that, but Paul didn't. He didn't say, like you two, living in sin. He just said, let me tell you about a righteous standing. You have to be perfect. Do you think that they were looking at themselves saying, oh my gosh, we got a long ways to go? So he didn't need to point it out. He shared the truth. Does that make sense? Second piece that he says is he speaks about self-control. It's interesting. Have you found, I find this fascinating, that man can control. We've been able to tame everything, but ourselves. Isn't that crazy? You can tame a lion and an elephant. I mean, go to the animal park. You can see the things they've tamed. But we can't tame ourselves. So I think this is fascinating that Paul shares that with these two. Why? Because remember, they had no self-control. Felix, he's, I want that chick. But she's already married. I don't care. I want her anyway. What do I got to do to get her? Well, let's trick her. And he does, and she falls for it. I mean, no self-control whatsoever. The guy's a vicious guy, and he treats the Jews very harshly. In fact, that's what ultimately gets him demoted, is he tries to squash an uprising of the Jews, and he does it so brutally that Rome has to come in and say, okay, Festus, go take over, get him out of there, and he basically gets demoted. Drusilla ends up going to Pompeii. What happens in Pompeii? Does anybody remember? Mount Vesuvius explodes. Many believe that her and her son that they had together were burned alive in Pompeii. So Here, you know, Paul shares that it's self-control. But here's the funny thing. We can't even control ourselves. We must surrender. When we surrender into our lives into the hands of Jesus, we relinquish control of ourselves to someone who is greater in power and authority than ourselves. He provides self-control. In fact, it's one of the fruit of the Spirit. One of the evidences of the Spirit is that we now have self-control. We live in a world that is completely out of control. When we look at credit card debt is at an all-time high, it's people that say, I want it. Well, I don't have the money. I don't care. I want it anyway. So I'll use this magician called a credit card, and I'll get what I want, right? So it's a crazy time. These two were totally consumed with themselves. They're out of control. Felix, a crook, a murderer, a liar, Drusilla, Jew who had forsaken God, who was living in continual sin. And Paul says, but let me tell you what happens after you find righteousness, God takes control. And I can imagine that was probably sounding very, very interesting to those two. And so this third point was that judgment was on the way. Now, that's a great way to end that particular discussion with these two. He says, someday you're going to have to stand, all of us are going to stand before God and give an answer before God. And so can you imagine somebody like Felix and I am the king of all. I stand before no one. People stand before me. And Paul probably saying, oh, dude, you little wimpy little guy, you have to stand before. I find that a fascinating thing because you realize why many of the false religions that we have, many of the, when we consider the idea of people wanting to just, well, I believe that we evolved from single cell amoeba. Well, you may have, but I know I didn't, okay? We came from monkeys, gorilla. I mean, you look at all of that. Do you know, it's all so stupid when you think about it. It's foolishness when you think about the reality of the complex people that we are, the complex organisms that we are. If you've ever considered how even a baby comes into being, two cells come together, and then those cells start to multiply. And on each one of those cells, information is given on every one of those cells as to what that cell is going to become. This is going to be an eyelashes. These are going to be eyebrows. These are going to be fingernails. I mean, all that information is already in there before the cell even parted and became the cell. It was already, that evolved? Come on, please. Don't, you know, challenge our intellect here. But why is it? Why do people embrace it? Because they don't want to have to stand before God and give an answer to God. Do you understand? They don't want to be accountable to someone. They don't want to have to say, I have to stand before a righteous judge someday. So if I don't believe that he exists, then I don't have to face that reality. Well, sadly, whether you believe that God exists or not, people will still stand before him. They're going to stand before him either, as Paul said earlier when he was talking to the Sanhedrin, either as Jesus as your Savior or as your judge. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I'd much rather have him as my Savior. Because the wrath of God, see, Christians are not going to face the wrath of God. Why? Because Jesus faced that wrath, took that wrath, and we've put our faith in him, so the wrath of God was already poured out on him. We're not going to have to face that. But somebody that says, nope, I'm going to do it my way. In fact, I'm going to invent a song and sing that song. I did it my way, right? So, okay, you can do it your way. Go for it. But someday, the wrath of God will be poured out on the unrighteous. Who are the unrighteous? Well, I became righteous by my faith in Jesus, so therefore, those that have not put their faith in Jesus as the Savior are then the unrighteous. Does that make sense? So they're going to have to then face the judgment that they have basically embraced. I want to do it my way. I don't want to have to face God. I don't believe that there's a heaven. I don't believe that there's a hell. So I believe that when we die, we turn into worm food. Okay. Well, you're going to have to face God someday because he exists. All around us is proof that he exists. And so, listen, do you want to stand with him? And stand before him and have Jesus step up and say, this one's mine. He's not going to face your judgment. I'm taking him off to the side. He's on my side right here. I don't know about you guys, but that's where I want to be. And how do you get that? You surrender now. It's interesting. And so judgment is on the way. And so I wonder at this particular point in time, you know, as the response of Felix, it says he trembled. If you look that word up in the Greek, it literally means he quaked like an earthquake. He freaked out, in other words. That's a Greek term for he went into freak out mode, right? He could not handle it. Paul, you need to leave. You need to leave. And as awesome as Paul's message was, a captive audience between two people and Paul himself with two people, it's crazy because what was missing with Felix and Drusilla? A response. He said, I can't handle this, dude. You need to leave. You need to leave right now. He was afraid. He had heard enough to be afraid of what he heard, but even that fear didn't lead him to a place where he said, Paul, what do I need to do to be saved? Isn't that crazy? So fear is not always a great indicator. People can cry, but if you do not say, I want that, I want Jesus, I recognize I am a sinful person, I need to be saved. My life has been a mess. I mean, Felix could have repented right there on the spot, but he didn't do it. Drusilla could have repented right there on the spot. She didn't do it. She needed to make a choice. They didn't make a choice. So isn't that interesting? Is not making a choice a choice? Yeah. Yes, it is. Fascinating, right? The choice they made was, no, not today. So he basically what he did is he procrastinated. He procrastinated. In fact, in my Bible right here, it says Felix procrastinates. That's kind of the theme right there. And so, you know, well, Paul, let me think about it. I'll get back to you on that. Gang, I have talked to so many people that have told me that same thing. You know what? I'm not ready yet. But let me think about that. I think that sometimes the more that we have an opportunity and we procrastinate, it becomes easier to procrastinate the next time. Have you noticed that? Becomes easier and easier. And, you know, like people said, I'm going to stop procrastinating starting tomorrow. Works for me, right? But here, quivering lips, shaking hands. I don't know, man. This is radical. But it wasn't enough to make him say, I surrender. He wouldn't give up that pride. He wouldn't let it go. He refused to make a choice, so it is a choice. It's interesting, Paul will later, I wonder if it was in his head, because he writes to to the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 2, listen to what he says. At just the right time I heard you. On the day of salvation I help you. Indeed, God is ready to help you now. Today is the day of salvation. When we get to speak at Camp Pendleton, man, we don't give them tomorrow. We give them now. Because many of these kids don't know where they're headed, right? We give them now, and they make decisions now. And I think that is something so very important. But I wonder if he got scared because he knew, I don't have a leg to stand on. I'm an evil person. I'm sinful. I'm full of pride. I'm full of arrogance. But I don't want to give up what is important to me. I know I'm living with this girl that I shouldn't be. I took another man's wife. I mean, some people go to war with God over what they're holding on to because they don't want to let it go. So they're holding on to a trash can full of trash, and Jesus is saying, give me the trash can, and I'll give you all of my goodness. I'll forgive you of that sin. I'll give you righteous standing with God. I'll give you a new heart. I'll take away the weight and the guilt that you're carrying around in that trash can. And people say, well, but this trash is important to me. Rob, I've been carrying it for a long time. I mean, I don't know what I'll do without it. Isn't that interesting? When he's willing to make a trade. I was pondering this, you know, because last week when Bree was talking about the swap meet, it's kind of like a junk exchange. Notice that it's called the swap meet. So you're going to swap your stuff with other people's stuff. Jesus said, I want to swap with you all of my goodness for all of your badness. And all you got to do is give it to me. And he went, I can't do that. He held on to it, to his demise. So sadly, as I shared with you a moment ago, did he ever make the change? Unfortunately, no. And neither did Drusilla. Will they be able to stand before God and say, I didn't know? No, they won't. because they called Paul on many more occasions. Let's listen to him again. Let's listen to it again. And so they had many opportunities to hear the truth, and they refused to surrender to that truth. Isn't that crazy? So when they get, they're not going to say, God, I didn't know. When they have to stand before God as a judge, they're not going to be saying, I didn't know. Because Paul would be standing there saying, well, you knew because I talked to you. Do you remember that? They say, no, I don't remember that. You know, they'll try to lie their way out of that. So he refused to give up the lifestyle. And you know what? I think it's so sad because I run into that, as you may also, to those people that say, well, do I have to stop doing this? Do I have to stop smoking weed? Do I have to stop that? They'll tell you, and I'll say, listen, I'm not telling you what you have to stop. Why don't you just surrender to Jesus and let him work those details out? But they want to know what they got to give up first. Isn't that crazy? So things that he thought were more important than eternity, now he realizes I made a bad exchange because it's too late for him. Jim Elliot, you know, you may have heard of him, great missionary. He said, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Very powerful words, right? So I think for you and for me as Christians, man, don't wait. When you've got major decisions to make, don't wait on that. If God convicts you of something, deal with it quickly. Repent quickly. If you know you've messed up, if you know you did something wrong, if you know you hurt somebody, you know you lost your temper, you know, whatever it may be, even for us as believers. And the Lord says, Rob, right there. I want to deal with that. If he exposes something in your heart and he shows it to you, then deal with it quickly. Don't procrastinate. Don't say, I'll deal with it tomorrow. I'm just having fun today. I'll deal with it tomorrow. You know, I encourage you, get rid of it quick. Don't wait. If you're having an argument with your spouse, don't say, I'll tell her I'm sorry tomorrow. You know, you tell her today, right? Don't wait till tomorrow. Do it now. Be the first one to apologize. Well, but I apologized first last time. So what? Shut up and apologize. Do it now, right? Don't wait to ask your children to forgive you if you blew it. Don't wait to patch up. If you have an opportunity, put forth the effort. Don't procrastinate what you can do today. Does that make sense, gang? Because I know some people, you know, have never got their chance, just like Felix and Drusilla. They didn't get their chance. So, funny, he wants to be bribed. I wish I could let Paul go. If he would just offer me some money. Where did that come from? Well, Paul told him, I brought money to the Jews in Jerusalem. You got any more? Offer me something, so I'll let you go. But obviously, he did not know the character of Paul. So, I want to show you something, though. He leaves him there for 2 years. Isn't that interesting? So, what did Paul do during that 2 year window of time? I'll tell you a couple of things. He said, let anybody come and visit him. Do you know? I want to show you at least a couple of things. Number one, there is not one record of James from the Church of Jerusalem coming to visit Paul. Not one indicator of any of the leadership from the church in Jerusalem coming over to Caesarea to visit Paul. Could Paul have gotten bitter about that? Stinking guys, I go there, I give them money, I go there to bless them. They want me to go up and do this little thing on the Temple Mount. All right, I'll do it. I go up there, I do it. It turns into a riot, turns into three riots. Now I get arrested, I'm sent. Where's the church when I need them? Could he have done that? Sure he could have, but he didn't do that because he realized, because remember when he was feeling probably at his worst, when he was sitting there all bummed out thinking, Lord, I totally blown it. I thought I could come here and share. I thought you wanted me to do this. Remember Jesus showed up and said, Paul, you did good and don't you worry about it. I'm with you. Yeah, maybe James isn't. Maybe the guys from the church aren't here for you, but I'm with you and you're going to Rome, Paul. And so Paul held on to that promise. So what did he do with some of that time? I had heard and I read that it's possible. Now, I'm a guy that believes, because some people say, we don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. I'm a believer that Paul wrote it. You can disagree with me if you want to be wrong. That is fine with me, okay? But I believe that Paul wrote it. Think about this. When would have been the most perfect time for him to write that? Right after he had been to Jerusalem, when he had faced these guys, when he had watched them reject Jesus, they were embracing the system instead of the creator of that system. Are you with me? They want to worship on the Sabbath day. They had this high regard for angels. They were not at rest. What does all Paul deal with in the book of Hebrews? He talks about how Jesus is better than the Sabbath. Jesus is better than the angels. He is even above Abraham. He talks about a rest that their forefathers were not able to appropriate because they didn't mix it with faith. Everything that is written in the book of Hebrews, it's almost like it could have come right on the heels of Paul's visit to Jerusalem and his kind of like fresh impression of what had just transpired while he was there. So whether you believe that or not, it's okay. But here's what I want you to know is that God doesn't waste anything, gang. Paul's sitting there for 2 years. Do you think he just, you know, sitting there getting mani-pedis and, you know, hanging out, you know, swimming laps and out in the Mediterranean? Or if you know Paul, he used his time wisely. And God was preparing him for something. What is he preparing him for? To go to Rome. So Pastor Chuck, in his book, I think I've shared it with you guys before, one of his last books, he wrote, everything that you go through is preparation for the next thing. And at this particular point, Paul had been through a lot, and God was preparing him to go to Rome. I really, after putting those pieces together, I really believe he wrote Hebrews at this particular time, because it makes sense. But what I say is God used this time to prepare Paul to go to Rome. And so, gang, I can tell you, he doesn't waste anything. So what are you going through right now? Some of you guys are going through some tough stuff. You know, when we think about some of our own brothers and sisters that are, you know, battling with cancer and even my own little brother right now who, you know, because of all that he went through, his kidneys have shut down, so he's having to do dialysis. I had to pick him up from his dialysis treatment yesterday. And I shared with him, Kurt, God's not done with you yet. And so I can tell you that some of the things that I have gone through personally that have been some of the most difficult times of my life, that the disease that I had, the surgery, the complications after the surgery, for Mari and I, in the early years of our marriage, when God was, you know, doing crazy stuff in our marriage, 10 years, I had a pastor tell me, Rob, I believe God's called you to be a pastor. Right after we got married, I go, interesting. And so I went home, told Mari, and I said, Mari, you know, that his name was Richard also. I said, Richard believes that God's called me to be a pastor. What do you think? She goes, ain't no way. I am not going to be married to a pastor. I am not going to work full time so you can go out and play golf and eat, do lunch. Because that's what her idea. She grew up in the Baptist church. I guess that's what the Baptist guys do, you know. I hate golf anyway, so. But lunch I can do. I can do, you know. So guys, 10 years later, that reality came back up. What was God doing in that 10-year period of time, preparing me for the next thing? He had to do surgery on my pride and my self-centeredness, and I tease people all the time that God used a dirty, rusty scalpel with no pain medication when he had to take my pride out of me. It was a painful time. Mari and I, our early days of marriage were some of the most painful, difficult times for both of us. But yet God was doing something that he says, I'm going to use you guys because Mari, what you've been through in your childhood, the abuse that you suffered, and Rob, the things that you are now learning, I'm going to use you guys to help others go through the same thing. Did we know that at the time? No. But isn't it interesting? God doesn't waste anything. The stuff that we went through both physically, emotionally, the things that we've been through as a couple, individuals. Guys, what are you going through right now? You might be thinking, I don't understand, Lord. Why is this happening to me? I don't know. But I can tell you this. He's preparing you for something. What is it? I don't know. But go to him and say, Lord, what are you doing with me? I mean, I was literally saying, God, I don't understand. Why is this happening to me? And God, I didn't get answers. God didn't say, well, Rob, here's what's going to happen. I'm going to allow you to suffer because I'm cutting the pride out of you. Now, I wish I could say that all the pride was gone, right? I wish I could truly say to you, my pride has been humbly removed. But would that be a prideful statement? I think it would be, right? But I think for all of us, that's going to be a battle for the remainder of our lives. But I can tell you, man, for those early days, that it had to be surgically removed. But yet, God knew, Rob, I'm going to use that later so that you can help other husbands that are married to girls that have been abused like your wife has. And he gave us a niche that I didn't ask for, but he knew what he was doing. He knows what you're doing. He knows what he's doing with you. He knows what you're going through. He knows your situation. He knows what you're going through emotionally, physically, spiritually. He knows what's happening. And you might be thinking, God, how long is this going to go on? Paul sat there for 2 years, but he used that time, and God used his time to prepare him for something greater. So God has something for you. What is it? I don't know. I can't wait to find out. But Rob, you don't understand how bad this hurts. I may not, but that doesn't matter to me because God knows, and he's going to use it for something. Does that make sense, gang? Lord, we say thank you for the story of Paul, for what he went through. I pray for my brothers, my sisters that are here today right now, Lord, for those that are watching us online. Lord, that whatever we might be going through, you have a plan for it. If we'll just let you do it, if we will then make ourselves available and say, Lord, the comfort that you're giving comfort to me right now, Lord, use me to comfort someone else. And Lord, I believe that you are preparing a little army here for what you want to do in the future. Use us, Lord. Thank you that you made us righteous in Christ. And Lord, that's something that we did not deserve, but boy, do we enjoy it. So Lord, watch over these, my brothers and sisters, that we leave this place today. Give us boldness, give us strength and courage to meet the day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, you guys. Why don't you stand up with us? May the Lord bless you. May he watch over you. May he give you strength and power that you didn't know you had by the power of his Spirit as you relinquish your control into his control. Does that make sense? Let's sing one more, shall we, gang?
Thank you.
church. God is good all the time. God is good. Ooh, amen.